welcome to KSKQ 89.5 Ashland, Oregon Community Supported Radio. This is your brain in the cybersex jungle. I am Gary Wilson. This show contains adult themes, so please tell the kids to leave the room. Disclaimer time, the Your Brain in Cybersex Jungle show is informational only. It is not medical advice. If you need medical advice, please see your doctor. The central theme of the show is how internet pornography impacts young men, their experiences, and the science behind what they are experiencing. You can visit www.yourbrainonporn.com. That's my website. It has video presentations, FAQs, many articles, links to forums. We will also have links to this show today that will actually explain things further, because it's going to be somewhat complex material about the adolescent brain. This week's show is about how the adolescent brain differs from the adult theme. Now, this is actually the major theme of this entire show, so we will continue it on and on throughout many shows. In fact, the next couple shows. You know, it's far more vulnerable to addiction than at any other time, the adolescent brain. And it's really a critical period of development where you have tremendous growth followed by rewiring, and this rewiring can last a lifetime. So it's going to take a little bit of explaining. Now, a little bit of background is that I often see debates on the pros and cons of adolescent use of internet porn. Now, what I see missing a lot of time is the recent discoveries in neuroscience. It's actually very shocking to me how recent addiction neuroscience is completely ignored, and how especially the recent discoveries about the adolescent brain and how different it is from an adult brain are also ignored. The thing to get is that the adolescent brain is not an adult brain with less experience. It's not about learning. The adolescent brain is anatomically, biochemically, and physiologically quite different from a child's brain and from an adult's brain. So this is, of course, really important to know, because so many kids are starting internet porn use at about the age of 11 or so, maybe even daily use. And a stash of Playboys that maybe I found when I was young, which I certainly did, is not the same as sitting in front of a computer starting at age 11 with 20 tabs open, clicking from scene to scene, or walking around with my smartphone and watching porn during recess. It's a different world. So the old model is that the brain is fully cooked and grown up by childhood. And that what that means is it simply learns from there on out. Now, this is probably believed because the brain is about 95% of the adult size by age 6, and larger, a little bit larger than the adult size by about age 12. And this is what psychologists and sexologists learned in school, and it's all wrong. The current model is that adolescent is a time of tremendous brain changes and rewiring to one's environment. What's also new is that adolescence really continues in terms of brain changes until about age 25. This is a critical window of development, and it has a purpose for all mammals. Here's a quote from one expert. Adolescence is a window of opportunity for developing a better, smarter, faster brain. It is the time when the brain becomes more efficient and develops more advanced skills. But it can also be a time of missed opportunities and vulnerabilities if a teen does not challenge his or her brain or exposes it to brain neurotoxins. Similar to what happens in early childhood, adolescent brain development is a period of use it or lose it. Brain connections that are stimulated and used repeatedly grow stronger, while unused connections wither away. How teens spend their time, their activities, and experiences influences both the organization and also the capacity of the brain, unquote. So what is different about an adolescent brain? Well, there are two main features. The first feature is there's this imbalance of power between the thrill-seeking parts of the primitive brain and the more evolved, rational brain. The second feature is that there is an explosion of new brain connections followed by a rapid pruning and reorganization. So let's look at the first feature. During adolescence, a temporary neurological imbalance develops. The way I like to say it is that the sex, drugs, and rock and roll part of the brain is in overdrive, while the let's give this some thought part of the brain is still under construction and won't reach maturity until adulthood. So the sex, drugs, and rock and roll part of the brain, and novelty part, I should say, is the ancient reward circuit. The adolescent has much stronger go-get-it signals. As the science journalist David Dobbs explained, we all like new and exciting things, but we never value them more highly than we do during adolescence. Here we hit a high in what behavioral scientists call sensation seeking, the hunt for neural buzz, the jolt for the unusual or unexpected. This love of thrills peaks around age 15. Unquote. The brain sensitivity to dopamine, the go-get-it neurochemical, peaks and spurs novelty seeking during this time. And so teen brains will respond to anything perceived as exciting as maybe two or four times more exciting. And this is measured by measuring the reward circuitry activation. This is due to dopamine sensitivity being much higher in adolescence and much higher spikes of dopamine. So it's really, really quite powerful. Now, not only are the teen brains pumping out more dopamine and other reward neurochemicals like THC, they produce higher levels of the addiction molecule, which we've talked about, called delta-phos-B. The accumulation of delta-phos-B can cause many brain changes that lead to addiction. So really, high dopamine, high sensitivity to dopamine, and then high levels of delta-phos-B is what make adolescents far more vulnerable to addictions, which in fact they are. Now, the other half of this imbalance of power is weaker stop signals. A teen brain is sort of like a Ferrari engine with Ford Pinto brakes, if you can remember the Ford Pintos. At puberty, this extremely overreactive accelerator, it comes online, and it's the reward circuitry, and it overpowers the brakes, which is actually the frontal cortex. The frontal cortex is right behind the forehead, and this is the higher brain, and it won't mature until about age 25, probably the reason why insurance companies have higher rates for drivers under 25. The frontal cortex has many jobs, but it controls impulses, inhibits inappropriate behavior, and weighs the consequences of actions. So that's not quite online yet. So teens often base their choices more on emotional impulses, which come from the deeper brain, and they have trouble perceiving the consequences of going for it. Now, this is no accident. This imbalance of power has an evolutionary purpose. And what is that? Well, all social mammals exhibit these same characteristics, and they are first, increased risk-taking, and second, increased sensation-seeking. Both of these help animals leave home, explore new territory, and most importantly, eventually find mates outside their group. So the purpose, one big purpose, is to get these people, guys usually, geared up so that they avoid inbreeding and allows them to mix up genes. Put simply, it's really genetic variety of the offspring. That's one of the major purposes. In the case of today's adolescent brains, there's really been no evolutionary time to adapt to these hazards of recreational drugs or fast cars, or of course the excess consumption of junk food or video games or even internet porn. So that's really the first major feature of the adolescent brain, imbalance between the reward systems, which are firing up, and the impulse control, which isn't quite online yet. The second major feature of the adolescent brain is very important. It's an explosion of new brain connections followed by a pruning and rewiring. So we're using the term pruning, and that's exactly what happens. If you can think of a pruning of a bush, it does look like that under a microscope. So around age 11 in boys, there's perhaps an explosion of 50 to 100 billion new nerve connections. And these new nerve connections are called gray matter. Now, gray matter is the outer, thin outer layer of the brain. And this gray matter is where all the magic of the brain occurs. It's where we have reason, logic, creativity, and of course, rational thinking. Now, the gray matter actually thickens during adolescence. So around this time, 11 and 13, depending on your sex, is the peak of gray matter. And then these billions of new nerve connections are pruned back so that the gray matter actually thins. In fact, our brain shrinks a little. So this is a big event and the major event in adolescence. As the top expert, Jay Gee, described, I'll quote him, "The pruning down phase is perhaps even more interesting because our leading hypothesis for that is the use it or lose it principle. Those cells and connections that are used will survive and flourish. Those cells and connections that are not will wither and die. So if a teen is doing music, sports, or academic, those cells and connections, they will be hardwired into the brain. If they are lying on a couch or playing video games or watching MTV, those are the cells and connections that are going to survive." Unquote. That's Jay Geed, and I'll have a link to his lecture on this on my site. The takeaway from all this, the environment matters because it shapes the adolescent brain, really shapes it. Not only do those bushy tree-like connections get pruned, but there's these long telephone-like wires between brain regions so that different parts of the brain can communicate and come up with an instantaneous decision. Now, they become a whole lot faster. So these cables between brain regions become covered in white matter. It's called myelin. And this is the insulation that speeds up nerve impulses. It can speed up nerve impulses 100 times faster once these cables get fully insulated. So in essence, the brain becomes far, far more efficient. The good news for us older people is that white matter continues to increase into our 40s and 50s. So I guess we become more efficient in certain things, but we lose options. Here's the analogy that Jay Geed came up with, and I really like it. So think about Kansas before the interstate system. It had many roads. They were all gravel, but they're very orderly, maybe a quarter mile apart, and you could drive down the road and turn off wherever you wanted to. Now, the roads that got used a lot eventually got paved, and then they got used more. And the ones between the cities that really got used a lot became multi-lane interstate highways. So now you can zoom down the interstate, but you can't turn off every quarter mile. So simplified, this means that we gain a lot of efficiency and maturity, but we lose a lot of possibilities and options. Here's a quote again from Dobbs describing the whole process. "The cortex prunes away little-used circuits while strengthening well-worn neural pathways. Nerve cell axons in favored pathways, that would be the highways, become better insulated, increasing the speed of nerve impulses. And the little branches that receive messages grow like vines to better hear the incoming signal. The connections between nerve cells multiply on strong circuits and vanish on weaker ones. In the end, you have the memories, skills, habits, preferences, and ways of coping that stand the test of time." Unquote. You are listening to Your Brain in the Cybersex Jungle. I am Gary Wilson. This is KSKQ 89.5. And we're discussing the differences of the adolescent brain and how that applies to massive use of the internet. So this quote pointed to how the adolescent brain is perfectly adapted to the hunter-gatherer society because the rewiring created a brain that could live anywhere on the planet. That's what makes humans so great. And the brain was precisely attuned to each unique environment and the tribal customs. But today, a 13-year-old's sexual pathways are actually being shaped by hardcore porn, multiple windows, and constant clicking. So years of rewiring often occur before these young kids have their first sexual encounter or even their first kiss. It's like hypnotic web surfing requiring no effort, but clicking a mouse has replaced leaving one's tribe to search the savannah for fertile females. Well, that's not good. These kids are glued to their screens. A young guy is not learning courtship skills or really interacting with potential partners, the very task for which the adolescence is meant. That's why we evolved adolescence. So in essence, a young guy's brain is not wiring his sexual pleasure to flirting or pheromones or three-dimensional partners of, let's say, normal proportions. Now, the argument, when we discuss this, there's one argument that comes up. Internet porn is like video games, and that violent video games don't cause violence, so watching porn won't cause sexual crimes or sexual deviance. Well, that's not really relevant. See, the way I think about it, porn doesn't create rapists any more than video games create ninja killers or soldiers or anything else. The thing to remember, the difference between video games and watching porn is that there are no innate circuits for World of Warcraft or Grand Theft Auto. See, I can't even say these things because I don't watch video games. Or any of these other video games. But there are innate sexual circuits that are being molded and pruned and shaped during adolescence. And in this case, they're being molded and shaped by internet porn. That's what adolescence is all about, is rewiring the brain to everything sexual. Well, this brings up the subject that is in the news. Here's our In the News this week. The headline that came out a couple days ago is, "Are Our Kids Becoming Internet Porn Addicts?" This is from London, where a study was done. Here's the main byline. Children as young as 11 are being given unrealistic expectations of sex after being exposed to internet pornography, according to research in Britain. Academics warn that what is becoming common practice for children is to become desensitized to sexual images after accessing hardcore images at an early age. So that's the quote. Now, we see this all the time. We see guys describe how years of internet porn has affected how they respond to girls. They don't get excited by girls. They'll be using porn starting at age 12, and then by 18, when they actually have a sexual encounter, they may have erectile dysfunction. They may have loss of libido. They just don't get that excited because the real girl doesn't compare to what they actually wired their brains for. It's a mismatch. It's a neurological mismatch that's occurring. Here's one example. Here's a quote from an actual guy. "When I was 18, I had sex for the first time. When she said yes, I ran to the nearest store to pick up condoms like I had the Grim Reaper chasing me. After the deed, my thoughts were, it didn't feel any better than masturbation and required a heck of a lot more work. You know, I think I'll just stick to porn and not bother with a girlfriend." Isn't that amazing? I can't believe it, as I remember my 18-year-old days. Here's another quote from the article. "Some people are getting hooked on porn and then they are not able to perform in the real world. It can give people unrealistic expectations. It can be very damaging to people." And it does change one psychologically, and it can change one's expectations. But I think what they're missing again in that quote is how the adolescence is rewiring its brain to need a certain level of stimulation, a certain type of stimulation. So the adolescent brain is wiring to sitting and watching, seeing a full screen, maybe with multiple actors going through motions, listening to the oohs and ahs and screams of women. And this is not real sexual activity, and it doesn't match it. So we have pruned our brains, if we're an adolescent, for a certain type of sexual activity, and then come the time that we actually do it, there's a mismatch, and we go, well, this isn't what I prepared for. And then that's when the sexual dysfunctions occur. Here's another guy describing his problems. It's really hard to get erections when I'm trying to have intercourse. It takes about 20 minutes or so to get it up. Really embarrassing. But if I'm sitting and watching porn, it's almost instantaneous. So listen to that. This is new in our evolution. It's never happened before that a large portion of a generation is being exposed to supernormal stimuli of high-speed internet porn before they even become sexually active. Another quote from this is, the research surveyed about 1,000 young people, some saying they first watched pornography at age 11 and 12. One secondary school pupil, age 14, told researchers he couldn't believe there was anyone in his year who hadn't seen it. The researcher added, if this is how you first come across this sort of thing, that is a concern. If you have someone accessing hardcore porn at the age of 12, what is that going to do to them? Well, that is the question. So I don't want to be an alarmist, but I want to be a realist. And a realist is that the brain of an adolescent is, in fact, different. And I want all those who debate this to really realize it. It is not a smaller adult brain that hasn't learned anything. It is coming into the time when it is going to wire up to every sexual cue in its environment so that when it becomes an adult, it can reproduce. That is the job for all mammals. Here's one more quote from one of the guys on our site who's responding to another guy who said, you know, I just didn't get excited with the girl. My thoughts exactly. Much less stress just to masturbate. Plus, you got your own iron fist that gets you off better than the real deal. Not only that, you always get a good visual with a porn girlfriend. You can see all those beautiful body contours in perfect lighting, in high definition. In real life, that's rarely the case. The first time I did it, I didn't really enjoy it. My first time should have been like a triumph, but it felt artificial. It was then I knew there was something a bit wrong with me. The sex in my mind always seemed sexy and enjoyable. The real sex I had was primarily industrial and non-exciting. This is not good, unquote. So what we've been talking about is the adolescent brain, how it's different, and how it can rewire itself to its environment. And that means the environment matters. And if it's video games, if it's internet porn, if it's watching the TV, that matters because that's what it gets used to. So I'd like to end this show with next week, we're going to go ahead and continue this and discuss many of the sexual problems that occur with guys who grow up on internet porn. And the week after that, we are going to have guests that's actually going to discuss his particular situation where it took him up to 9 months. He's 21, up to 9 months to recover from sexual dysfunction and regain normal sexual activity. This is KSKQ 89.5, and you've been listening to Your Brain in the Cyber Sex Jungle.